All right, I have a minute after the hour. I think we'll get this started. My name is Vern Fish. I am the president of the Friends of Wabakimi. I will remind everybody that we are recording, but I have the ability to edit anything out that's inappropriate or embarrassing. Program tonight is the Wabakimi Canoe Route Guide by Laurence Mills. But I want to give our board chair just a moment here to talk about something else that's going on that involves the Wabakimi Canoe Route Guide. So Dave McTeague, can you give us a very brief update on the membership package coupon?
I sure can. It was part of our Canoe Copia and Go Adventure Toronto planning guide. We have a special deal going for membership. You can get membership right now at a very good price and get the Wabakimi Canoe Routes Guide that we're talking about tonight. You can also get a folded planning map, two of our very best items for planning your Wabakimi trip. And we really need your membership to build this as a strong organization to advocate for the habitat and the canoe routes of Wabakimi. So please check out our membership package coupon on our website and consider joining Friends of Wabakimi.
It's a heck of a deal, guys. All right, with that said, I want to kind of give everybody an update on the Wabakimi webinar series. We've had a series of five. These are the topics that we've already been through. And I want to thank Rob Kessering and Mary Blaisdell and the Park Superintendent Shannon Lauer for the first four. But tonight, we're going to be talking about the Wabakimi Canoe Route Guide by Laurence Mills. Part of the vision for the Friends of Wabakimi is that Wabakimi will be an exceptional wilderness destination, but one of our objectives is to provide materials to help visitors safely plan and execute a trip. And we're very proud to be able to say that Laurence Mills has helped us put together a book called the Wabakimi Canoe Routes Guide. Laurence has been, I'm going to let Laurence introduce himself, but he started out in England and he's traveled the world and he's developed a passion for canoeing. So with that said, I'm going to exit out of this and give Laurence the floor. Laurence, can you tell us a little about where you've been? And
I will correct a little bit of a statement there. I haven't traveled the world. Yeah. Europe and much of North America, but my name is Laurence Mills. I was born in the UK, as you may have already realized, more precisely in London. I've lived in and traveled through a number of European countries, I decided that I needed to move around. I needed to travel. So I came to Canada, became a Canadian citizen, was able, courtesy of my job at the time, to live in most of the major cities across the country. Also, a little later, courtesy of my job, I was able to spend some time in the Caribbean, which at the time was an invitation I accepted because my wife and I were both very keen scuba divers. So that worked out very well. I don't think a weekend went by when we weren't in the water, under the water, I should say.
Because you were actually in the Cayman Islands for a while, were you not?
For a while, yes. And more particularly the Bahamas. Finally, we decided that we would come back to Canada, to Toronto specifically. We had considered, in view of my wife's US background, she is a citizen, considered a number of Boston, a number of places in the US, but finally decided that Toronto was the place. We returned and
frozen.
After 13 years away from Toronto, we discovered when we returned that it had changed. The business environment had changed. I didn't care for it anymore. We had lived in small towns and much more friendly places. And we decided that it wasn't going to work for us after about 7 or 8 months. So we started to look north and finally wound up here in the North Bay area. I was just trying to think. I think I was 55 at the time. And the first winter, let me just mention how I came across canoeing. I had never considered canoeing. I had never sat in a canoe. It just hadn't occurred to me as a possibility. But when we moved north, the snow was deep, it was winter. I got a book from the library, happened to be on canoeing. I thought, I can do this. Wait till the spring, and got a map of one of the larger scale maps or smaller scale, I should say, with more on it, of Northern Ontario, and discovered the rivers, the lakes, the parks. And I was within an hour of two of the major parks in mid-Ontario. It's interesting when Torontonians think about Northern Ontario, they think Muskoka, which is about halfway up, maybe, you know, a couple of hours out of Toronto. When you really go north, as we have, you discover zillions of rivers, lakes, canoeing areas. Temagami is an hour away from where I am. I should also mention that Algonquin is probably 45 minutes from where I am. So come spring, I rent a canoe, I go down to Algonquin, I'm ready to put the canoe in the water, got all my gear packed for a 4 or 5 day trip. And I thought to myself as I stepped in the canoe, this is the first time I've ever actually sat in a canoe. Fascinating thought. Nevertheless, it worked out very well. I saw a couple of other groups on the way, well, canoes with tandem, two people in them, and discovered that I loved it.
So when did you discover Wabakimi, Laurence?
Well, very quickly after that, a couple of trips in Algonquin, a couple of trips into Temagami, and I thought I need somewhere where I don't see somebody else on every portage and almost every lake and river. And so I got out my map of Ontario and I looked to Quetico. Somebody had mentioned Quetico, and I thought, well, it's right next to the Trans-Canada Highway and the US border. And boundary waters. And I thought, it's going to be busy. I discovered later that I was wrong, but nevertheless, it put me off. So I'm looking at the map, I looked a little further north, and there's this huge green area, Wabakimi. So I thought, well, that's the place to go. So I did. I booked my first trip, geared up for a couple of weeks, called a number of the outfitters. And I have to say that Don Elliott came through and he said, look, if this is your first time in Wabakimi, you must paddle the Allanwater. Train out to Allanwater Bridge, north from there, and you can paddle right back into Little Caribou. And it's 5 kilometers from Armstrong, where my car was. So that worked out extremely well. Now, I did discover I was solo. I've always paddled a solo canoe, except on two occasions, but I took my dog. And I discovered immediately that the railways, Via Rail, doesn't like dogs on the train unless they're in a dog cage. So my question to them was, and I'm on the train now. The dog is underneath my legs, right against the seat. The train is moving. So, I mean, it's too late to turn me off, at least before I got on. In any event, they chose to look the other way, but I didn't make that mistake again. And the problem is, what do you do with a dog cage if you take a dog on the train when you get to the other end? You're in the middle of nowhere. And you're going to throw it away, leave it on the train, whatever. You know, it's an expensive business. So later, of course, we discovered that you can paddle in from a number of sources or origins. My first trip, Allanwater River, I was still relatively naive as a canoeist. I've paddled some swifts, but at that stage, I hadn't run rapids. And if you do the Allanwater River, you have to run a couple of rapids. There is no question. Fortunately, I met somebody on the way, and I learned very quickly. I also learned when I get home that I should practice, maybe take a couple of courses, and I'm on the way. In any event, Allanwater River seems to have everything you could want. It's got dramatic waterfalls, granite falls, a number of them. It's got lakes, it's got rivers, it's got fast water, great scenery. If you're lucky, you run across a bear and a moose. It's just a perfect river, I think, to start, and it was good advice. I would add from Matthijs Lake Outfitters. After that, I was in love with Wabakimi. Absolutely fascinated, had to go back, did so every year thereafter for a number of years, loved it. I also discovered on my first trip that there were no canoe route maps. I had to make my own.
Is that what led to wabakimimaps.com?
Well, it's what led to me making my own maps, and ultimately, yes. And I got there. My first thought was, there are so few visitors, relatively speaking, to any other park. It's got way less than Quetico. In terms of camping permits, overnight camping permits, much less. And I thought, and also you can paddle most of the routes without seeing another canoe. How can I tell people about that? How can I pass this on, get more people to visit, introduce Wabakimi to more people? And this was 20 some years ago. So I thought, write a book. So with the maps that I'd accumulated, I've created myself up to that point, I was going to put in a book with the narrative. I talked to a couple of publishers, and it seems that if you write a book and you push it out through a publisher, that they may hang on to it for a year. And then at the end of that year, tell you that they're not going to proceed with it. So I thought, well, I don't want to wait a year. B, I don't want to be told at the end of that I can't publish it. I need to get the word out now. So I thought a website, and that's wabakimimaps.com. I've added to that every year with every trip. It quickly became obvious that one person cannot paddle every route within the park. So I started in the park. I did Allanwater, Flindt, Boiling Sands, most of the rivers preceding, the Nemo River, which is quite interesting too. I'm very much less traveled. One person can't cover them all, so I need contributions. I had a number of inquiries from people after I first started Wabakimi Maps, do you have a map for such and such? So I said, well, I'll create the map. I don't have the data except what I've researched. I don't have personal data, but I will do the maps for you free. If you mark the data on them, portages, campsites, etc., and send them back to me afterwards. A number of people contributed. It was, I mean, the response was amazing. So Wabakimi Maps grew. The more routes I offered, the more inquiries I got. And interestingly, one of the most frequent questions that is asked of me is, what route is best for me? How do I pick a route out of all these routes? Where should I go? It's my first time in Wabakimi. It became apparent that we needed to produce something to give people a way to pick their own route or pick the right route for them. And hence my jumping at the opportunity when I got a call from Vern and Dave and John Holmes of Friends of Wabakimi, would you like to write a book from us for us on canoeing in Wabakimi? So it met my needs, which is to bring more people, publicize and invite more people, and also make it possible
for more people to sort of this idea of polarity, where if you love me, you don't have to.
I heard a voice. So as you can see, we have put in the guide a list of routes. You can see trip summaries and maps, Allanwater River, Flindt, Nemo. Most of the routes that emanate from the railway going north. So you can get the train out from Armstrong or places further east or west to the mileage point, which we put on our maps. And on the map descriptions, and unload at the beginning of your trip, the beginning of the route, and paddle out or whatever your choice is after that. But the routes that we have put in the book are summaries. They include a summary map, not only of the route we described, but all of the alternatives, the possibilities, how they hook up with other routes and so on. So in fact, you can design your own. We also include, and maybe Bernard will put up the page here of one of the map descriptions, a box with some statistics that help the reader choose a route. A number of factors come into play here. How long have you got? How much experience do you have? Do you want to do portages or not? You can't do a trip in Wabakimi without a portage. So what we do, we have a box at the top, as I say, with the alternatives, the main route and the alternative routes. We show the length of each of the routes that we've described, the time it might take. The time estimate that I put in are based on my experience and are very conservative. I'm a solo paddler, so I tend to paddle more slowly than others. We include the total number of portages, whether you run rapids and don't need a lot of them, obviously your choice, but a number of families. I've had fathers call and say, look, I want to do a canoe trip and I'm going to take my young son. So I need something fairly easy. So we've got choices for that too. We include the topo map numbers just in case you want to add a topographical map to your map case when you go. We show the access point. If it's on the railway, we give the mile marker. For you to tell the conductor. Incidentally, I should make a mention that if you go in by train, by boreal, you have to name the point where you want to be dropped off which is a mileage point. We list those in the guide. It's also worthy of note that when you book the train, and you must book ahead, if you want to come out by rail, the train will not stop at most of those stops unless you've made a reservation. So you need to reserve ahead, whether you begin your trip with a train ride or you can end it there. Having talked about the trains, and we list all of the routes that emanate from the railway line, there are points where you can shuttle in or drive in yourself. Little Caribou, the Ogogi Road, which goes out to and a couple of entry points on the Kopka River, which we include in our map book. We also include the Albany, which by and large is a fly-in route, depending upon how long you want to spend there. However, you can access from the highway to the west, goes up the west. I believe that's 599, 519. Since I don't have my map in front of me, it is, I will tell you. No, I don't. Okay. Osnaburg Lake, which is in fact part of the headwaters of the Albany River, you can put in there right from the highway. You're probably better off getting a shuttle to that point so that you've got some access back to your vehicle or however you came in at the end of the trip. Many people will fly in and have to Rockcliffe Lake and they will paddle up the Missinkell River from Rockcliffe Lake into the Albany, and then the route I show finishes up coming down the Pikitigushi into the Bush Road and is a shuttle back to Armstrong, probably where your flight started at Matice Lake or one of those places. There are several outfitters on Highway 527 that have flight services. We actually list them in the resources page. Vern, have you got resources page?
I do, but it's at the back. I'll get to it.
Okay, don't worry about it. But we list outfitters, we list local hotels for people who want to stay overnight after arriving before they get on the trip. We include emergency service numbers, the local OPP and so on, outfitters and guides, and various other useful resources from whom you can inquire and call and make arrangements.
One of the things, Laurence, that I think is very unique to what you've done is the narratives that go with these trip reports are your narratives. You've been there, you've seen it. And I mean, it's really.
Yes. Okay, stop on this one then.
Yeah.
Allanwater River, stop right there. Back it up a bit.
Go back up here.
No. Yeah. 31. Let's go to the description, which has the narrative you're talking about with some of the alternatives. It's got, if you start on the Allanwater River, you go right up to Wabakimi Lake. You can either come out more quickly on a shorter route through Smooth Rock and Little Caribou on the map here. Lower Wabakimi, Smooth Rock Lake.
Yep, there's the northern route and there's a southern route you're making reference to. The map's turned, so it's a little hard to see. And that's the railroad line going right there on the right side of the page.
The shorter trip is 9 or 10 days. The longer trip depending upon how long you stop along the way, of course, is 12 or 13 days. So, you know, a week and a half or 2 weeks. And let me mention, talking about Whitewater Lake, which was the northern route there. Whitewater Lake has a couple of things to see. There was a lodge built by the province of Ontario for as an echo lodge for the First Nations there. And it's built in the shape of a teepee. I don't think that it was operated as an echo lodge for very long. It became a corporate lodge, which is when I first saw it and got a tour of the place, and it was absolutely amazing. The main building is built in the shape of a teepee. Inside is huge. There's a balcony halfway up with rooms. There are cabins outside, and there is also a separate lodge with a number of, looks like motel rooms, but you can't drive there. It's an amazing thing to see. It was left in disrepair after the corporate lodge, after the corporation pulled out, after some years. They had a caretaker there who was an ex-lighthouse keeper, the last lighthouse keeper in Ontario, I do believe. In any event, he moved on to the Ogoki Lodge in Wabakimi. And when the corporation pulled out, obviously it was left empty and in some disrepair. It's since been bought by one of the outfitters, and I'm told it's going to be a fly-in lodge, if it isn't by now, for tourists, people who want to fish, and even canoeists, perhaps.
So Laurence, would you consider that one of the must places you have to see? Go ahead.
I think it is, given its history, the shape of the building, it's worth going to see. If it's occupied as a commercial lodge, it may not be appropriate to stop, but at least you can paddle by. And it's in some quiet water, you can take a look. If it is not being used yet, obviously you can take a much closer look. Also on Whitewater Lake, as you paddle further around, and it's a great trip actually, because you get to paddle through the lake, weave around islands, it's very scenic, likely you'll need some shelter from the southwest winds, plenty of that with the islands and so on. As you paddle around, right there, you can see Best Island marked on the map. Mm-hmm. Best Island has, up where the campsite is, on the top left-hand corner there, towards the top on the left, there you go, is Wendell Beckwith's cabins. Wendell Beckwith was actually, I don't like to call him a hermit, but he was an inventor. And there is a full page description of him, his background. He has seven or eight, he worked for Parker Penn for a while, and in the US obviously. Spent a number of years working at that sort of thing, and then decided he needed to be in a remote area away from the business of the world. So he moved to Best Island. He built out of pine trees in the area and stone and rocks and so on, a very large cabin, which he lived in. And it was quite amazing. It's left in some disrepair. The roof has finally fallen in, sad. Go and see it while you can. There are several cabins that he subsequently built around it. But the first thing he discovered was that the large cabin was just impossible to heat, during the winter. So he built a little, cabin into the hillside called the Snail, picture of it in the book. I thought you were coming up to it just then.
Yeah, it's a little further in. I'll get there.
But it's well worth seeing while it still lasts. The main cabin, as I say, is in some disrepair. The roof has fallen in. You can't go in anymore. Has this huge, amazing, fireplace built out of stone. It had a cold box for in the summer to keep his fresh food fresh and cold, lowered into a hole in the ground. So he holds this thing up with a rope. It sits on the kitchen counter or as high as. He can take out and put in what he needs, lower it back down again, and it's cool, probably about, 12 feet or so into the ground. Amazing. He built all of those things out of natural things that existed on the island, wood, trees. He carved cupboard door hinges for his kitchen cupboards. Absolutely amazing. Well worth seeing. The snail is still, I was going to say habitable, it's not. You can go in, there it is, there's the snail. You can still look inside, you can see the fireplace that he built with a revolving chimney such that it pointed in the right direction so the wind wasn't blowing down it, the wind was blowing, sucking the smoke out. Just very clever. I mean, clearly the guy was an inventor. Well worth seeing, must do. There's a campsite right there, a nice one. Other things to see in Wabakimi to keep an eye open for are pictographs. Some of them are many hundred years old. In fact, archaeologists have looked at artifacts that have been discovered, at pictographs, and so on and so forth in Wabakimi, and determined that it was actually an earlier peoples lived there 6,000 or 7,000 years ago. Amazing. In any event, few things remain from those times, but certainly the natural environment that they paddled through, certainly pictographs, paintings in red ochre that they mined locally, and they're fading. See them while you can. Please don't get too close and breathe on them or touch them or anything of that nature, because human perspiration and human touch will encourage them to deteriorate more quickly. So honor our predecessors in that area. What else can I say, Vern?
Well, have you seen a caribou? I mean, that's one of the... Talk about caribous, yeah. If you've got some experiences.
They are. In the spring, we try to encourage canoeists, if they do see one, they will have calves, to really keep a distance. Don't paddle any closer. They become frightened for their calves, and we don't need that. In fact, we try to avoid the areas in the spring when they're calving and they have young calves, where they might, where they habituate. They travel in herds. They travel individually. So you might see them and a calf, and that's about it. In any event, please be careful. Moose are much more familiar, much more frequently seen, many more of them in the park area. I actually saw a white-tailed deer in Wabakimi Provincial Park. Deer and moose generally don't inhabit the same areas. It's quite a surprise. What else can I say in terms of things to see? Well, let me move on to the guide again. It was, when I was asked to write it for Friends of Wabakimi, I jumped to the chance because it met one of my key goals, which was to describe Wabakimi to other canoeists, especially those who had never heard of it or never been there, and attract more canoeists to the area. It's remote, easy to get to, drive, train. It's just an amazing area, and you will not. You will not see too many other people. I paddled the Kopka River with my canoe buddy, and we saw one other canoe, I think, while we were on the trip. That was it. And that was very early on. And a couple of fishing boats on some on a couple of the larger lakes. That was it, fly-in fishing. There are fly-in lodges and outposts scattered throughout Northern Ontario, some of them within the park areas or around. I should also mention, in terms of the guide, that we cover, as you possibly quickly saw, the index page passed by on the list, that not only Wabakimi, which is where I started, I thought there are so many canoe routes that I should start in Wabakimi. The guide starts in Wabakimi, and then we started to move out, which meets perhaps some of the goals of the Friends of Wabakimi, who have explored many of these outlying routes, many of them historic routes that had to be recovered. They've done a wonderful job. We started to include some of those routes in the guidebook. More will be in future editions, I'm sure. We'll have to see how that progresses. We cover the Kopka River, the Brightsand River, Albany. Remind me, Vern, what else do we cover?
Oh my goodness. Well, you've got stuff on the Crown land on the west, as you pointed out, comes off of 599. You have routes on the east that come off of 527, particularly through the Armstrong Forest, which is one of the units that we're involved in helping. We're on the committee to put together a management plan for that forest, and some of the information that you have provided and that the Wabakimi Project provided have played a very important role in helping shape that forest management plan. So all this good work is helping protect those routes and hopefully ensure that there will be that wilderness experience of way beyond our trips through the woods.
Absolutely.
So, Laurence, are you at a point where you want to take some questions?
Absolutely, yeah.
All right. Let's see. How do I do this? Go ahead. I think you can unmute yourself and ask a question. We'll see how that works. Oh, wait a minute. Let me see if I got some chats here, and I haven't done a very good job of tracking them. Oh boy, goodness gracious here. Let's see. Try scrolling slower. Sorry, screwed that up. People are seeing woodland caribou on Whitewater Lake. Why don't you, if you've got a question, I think you should be able to unmute. If not, I will see how that works.
I do have a question. Does everybody hear me?
Yes, you're good. Talk.
Okay. Yeah, this is Don. The pictographs, do you have them marked on any of our maps? That I've got just about everything, but the only one I don't have yet, which I already ordered, is Lawrence's book. So how do we find pictographs?
We have been having some discussions with the park superintendent in Wabakimi. He would rather that we don't include in the book the exact location of pictographs. On the other hand, they are freely identifiable through Google. good old Uncle Google. So, you know, there's a problem here. My understanding is that the park superintendent will be speaking with some of the native bands. He feels that they would be upset. However, given that they're all over the internet anyway, personally, I don't see that it's a problem, but we haven't included them in the guide. The specific locations, they are on a number of our route maps, more detailed route maps, in terms of locations, how many of them there are, on each lake, for example, or river. We found one on the Brightsand River. There are a number on the Pikitigushi as you go down, particularly Cross Lake. I'm just trying to think of some of the other locations.
There's quite a few sites. I think you're absolutely right, Laurence. There's lots of information out there on trip reports, and you can find it. It's just not in one spot like the Quetico Boundary Waters. It takes a little more work to find them. Laurence, one of the questions that came up on chat was how do you obtain permits?
Oh, okay. We include that on our resources page at the back of the book. I think. Yeah. Somewhere. Whether. I'm just looking for this. Okay, no, we don't. We've got a page on permits in the guidebook. It covers the permits needed for non-Canadian travelers who, outside of the park, I believe, Vern, you can correct me on this, it's in the book, will need, you're muted, Vern.
You are correct. I'm trying to find the actual page. So it's actually on page 15 when you buy the book. It does talk about, and there is obviously a big difference between resident and non-resident. And I think one of the chat answers was you can work through your outfitter to get it. So the only challenge with that is if you show up and totally self-outfit, then you got to find some place to stop and pick up your permits on the way. It's a lot easier to work through an outfitter because they can take care of your fishing license and your permits all in one spot. So
yeah, that's true. For park permits, you can now, I understand, do it through the park website, Wabakimi Provincial Park website, and you can get park campaign permits on there. It's quicker and easier, and print your own. Yep. From that point, is my understanding. I think that covers the permit thing. We've covered it quite completely, I think. What permits are required for what areas? Wabakimi requires an overnight camping permit. So if you are traveling on a route in Wabakimi, for the portion of that route that's in the park, and some of the route, if you paddle in from or paddle out at Little Caribou, for example, that's outside the park. How many nights will you spend in the park? And you buy your camping permit accordingly. Kopka, Albany, Brightsand are non-operating parks, which basically means that the official portage clearing crews, park clearing crews, don't clear the portages. They rely on users, paddlers like you and I, with one exception. When it's easily accessible for a portage clearing crew, they will do the Kopka River, and they do. In my experience, even if you do the long route on the Kopka right from the headwaters, the portages are in great shape.
Laurence, you want to talk about how much whitewater? One of the questions is how much whitewater experience do you need for a trip down the Allanwater system?
I had next to none when I first went on my first trip. I did discover that there are a couple of rapids and fast water sections that you have to run because it wasn't at that time a portage. I believe there may have been our friends of Wabakimi, thank you, may have under the direction of Phil Cotton, may have put in portages that might have been missing. In any event, you do need some. You need to be able to run a C1, certainly. You need to be comfortable on fast water, swifts, and so on. It depends on the route. If you're doing the Kopka, there are a number of, the whole length, there are a number of fast water and C1 and C2 rapids that don't have portages, you'll need to run them. If you're doing the Albany, you need to have whitewater experience.
Yeah.
And Vern can attest to that. He's done the whole thing.
I'm gonna cut you off, Laurence, because the questions are coming in really fast here. Taking a train from Toronto.
There is a story. was way back when. No, real short comment.
Okay.
Of somebody portaging a canoe down Front Street to the main station in Toronto, and it was somebody took a photograph of it, which I saw. Ages, I don't know, 10 or 15 years ago. Anyway, the train goes from Toronto and you can go right into Armstrong or to one of the train drop-off points in the park. Yes, absolutely.
Yep, and you've got one of the beauties of the book and is that you've actually got all the mile markers identified, and that's very important because when you get on the train, you got to be able to tell the conductor where you want to get off exactly, because if you're coming from the east, you're probably going to be coming in the dark, so you really need to make sure you're in the right place. I'm going to answer one of these questions. Are the river portages and campsites marked? No. pretty straightforward on that. Laurence, what's the last date you would say you could paddle before you get froze out?
You know, the season really is, for me, June through September. September, you know, towards the end of the month, the first half is fine. The weather gets a little more iffy in September. June, July, and August are the best months. June, as you may have experienced, many of you already, black fly and mosquito season. Take your mosquito jacket or hood or whatever you use and even some spray if you need to.
I'm going to jump in. Go ahead, Laurence. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, May is a bit iffy at the beginning of the month because the ice is only just gone. If it has entirely, but yeah, May is usually good. Second half preferable, cooler, as September is cooler. Best months, June, July, and August.
Yep. I'm going to ask Dave McTeague to unmute because the next question I think Dave can answer better than anybody else is a question about anticipation for the 2021 visitation, given that so many southern parks, and I assume we're talking about southern Ontario, are fully booked. And Dave, based on our sales, what would your expectation be for the number of Canadians visiting Wabakimi based on our sales?
The interest level is high. We're selling maps and we're gaining memberships from a lot of people in Ontario and Canada. So we're not seeing as much from the US because I think we're waiting down here to see if the border opens. And we're hoping and praying for that, of course. But interest from Canadians is high. I mean, I think they're kind of stuck like we are. They're thinking what's closer to home that we haven't done yet. And all those folks in Toronto, we normally would go to Temagami and Killarney and Algonquin are maybe looking at Wabakimi for the first time. So I think you're going to see a lot of Canadians headed towards Wabakimi. That's our sense of it.
But a lot is a relative term in terms of Wabakimi.
Yeah, right.
It's a huge area, much bigger than any other park in the province, second largest park in the province, beaten only by polar bear park,
which is huge
up north there, and we don't canoe there.
Got a point there.
Another question, any information on the Witchwood River and a good choice to link White Clay to the Ogokee system and the Albany River system? I don't know that you deal with that in the book, but go ahead, Laurence.
Yes, we do. I think, in any event, it is mapped. For example, many people, one of the map sets that I sell from my website is to fly into Rockcliffe or out on the northwest end of the park, up to the Albany through the Missicow, along the Albany, down the Atwood and Witchwood River systems, into White Clay Lake, and then south on the Pikitigushi there to the road at the bottom. And a number of our current members have actually done that route.
I actually did it in 2016, took me 21 days, and it was spectacular.
It is.
Plus you get to visit Cliff Lake, which is a treat all to itself. So I'll let them figure that out. But
I do believe a little earlier when you were asking about pictographs, I talked about Cross Lake. It's Cliff Lake. My apologies. Thank you.
Yep.
You might tell them to come down the Shabasquea from Albany. Otherwise, they have to go all the way out to Opechuan. Yeah.
That is correct. Yep. That sounds like Ken. That is correct.
So just past Patty Lake, when you get to, just before Miminiska, I think, you cut down, what's it called again? Shabasquea, yep. Into the Atwood.
Yep.
I've not done that myself, but, and I don't map it, but I haven't mapped it, but I gather that a number of friends of Wabakimi have.
Yep, there's several trip reports posted on that trip. Another question is, are there any collection of GPS points stored anywhere? Laurence, no. you want to hit that one?
No, I haven't. When I first started, wasn't a thing, and I haven't done that since. I know a lot of people have. Some of the online canoe journals and map reports, trip reports, have included those. So they're around, not all of them, but I haven't included them.
Okay. Fern?
Yes, go ahead, Ken.
We mentioned Phil's attitude towards GPS on the Friends of Wabakimi maps was that if it's a cloudy day and we have a 5 meter accuracy, that's great. So we're within 5 meters of where a portage might start. If you're on a cloudy day and you have 5 meters accuracy, that 5 meters isn't exactly the same as our 5 meters. So you might be 7 or 8 meters out. And if you're approaching like at the Savant River Falls and you're 7 or 8 meters out, you might be holding on to your GPS as you go over the falls, cursing the stupid map. But, you know, like, what would you rather do? Be on a portage or holding your GPS and cursing the map? So we didn't put the GPS on the Friends of Wabakimi map because we couldn't guarantee accuracy. And that was attitude towards it.
Yep. Another question, Laurence, is does the park limit the number of entries per day like Quetico?
Oh, I make reference to it. I can't remember the numbers offhand, but I do make reference to that in the book and certainly on my website. There's a huge difference, absolutely huge difference. I mean, it's minuscule, the number that go to Wabakimi compared to permits issued for camping nights in Quetico. And obviously Wabakimi is much larger, so it needs more paddlers.
Well, and I guess I will speak to that. I mean, if this is the reason we're here is because the region is such a special place. But if there aren't voices, you go to wilderness to get away from people. But if there aren't enough people enjoying wilderness, then you don't have the voices to protect it. So there's a little bit of a trade-off there, but we need people to go paddle and tell the story, but we also need people to do it in a respectful way, because that wilderness is there because somebody spoke up for it, and the voices still need to be there. And if you've been there, you understand why it's so valuable and why we need it and why we need to protect it.
And why we need to keep it in its natural state.
Correct, correct. Other questions for Laurence? I'm doing the best I can to weave through all the chats, and there's quite a few of them. If I've missed something, or speak up if you've got some more comments. We may be at the point, Laurence, where you get to have the final word.
Well, I will apologize for the beginning. I am not a public speaker, as you could probably tell. It is something that I've always been quite awkward at, so I've avoided. However, I'm talking to fellow canoeists about something that we all love and want to get to know better. I thank you for the opportunity. The guidebook will help, I think, was designed for experienced canoeists to be able to find other routes, possibilities for those who've never been before and who may not have a lot of canoeing experience to be able to select routes, because we include statistics and a commentary that will cover both ends of the experience spectrum. So I think it will help people choose a route that best suits them, whether it's time, whether it's distance, whether it's portages, or whatever. And it will tell them what detailed canoe route maps they need to get for their trip. You can't paddle. The descriptions in the guidebook were not written for you to paddle from. They were written to help you choose the best route. Once you've chosen your route, you need a detailed canoe route map that shows you where the portages are, how long they're going to be, exactly where they start. Most of them are very close to the water hazards, whether they be rapids, falls, or whatever. And the portages start quite close. Obviously, nobody wants to carry a canoe for a further distance than they have to. So it requires a great deal of, it requires some knowledge ahead of time, i.e. the detailed route maps, and also care when you're paddling.
And I would add that the guidebook, along with the five map volumes that the Friends of Wabakimi make available and our planning map, work together to help you plan a trip. Yeah, I would encourage you to get all five volumes and the planning map, and then work with the guide to plan your trip. But if you have all that information in front of you, you should be successful in picking a route that's right for you. Laurence, can I let Dave have the floor just for a second too to talk about how to acquire these little gems we've talked about?
Absolutely.
The board chair, Dave McTeague.
Go to our website, www.wabakimi.org. We have a page on maps that takes you to our Wild Apricot interactive site. You can join there for our membership coupon special, or we have a map store where you can order our maps. Our prices are in Canadian, so you have to do some calculation if you're buying from down under. But the last thing I like to say is there's a few folks that are like new every time at these webinars. Please subscribe to our newsletter. Let us know who you are so we can send you notices in the future.
And if you want to hear more of Laurence, he will be on the virtual booth that the Friends of Wabakimi will have at Canoeacopia, which is coming up this weekend. Dave, you want to kind of talk about that quickly too?
Yes, we're having a live stream booth at Canoeacopia. I knew Bruce Heyer is going to be there as well.
Bruce.
And we are going to be running some of our webinars. We'll probably replay this webinar. We're hoping to have Laurence available for some live stream talk to continue this discussion and answer questions. There's a lot of good speakers at Canoeacopia. Jerry Vandeveer has a few performances scheduled. Several of our other board members have speaker sessions. Mary Jean and Amy are doing a special on women in solo canoeing. So I think Canoecopia has got a lot of interesting speakers, and it's worth the $15 to buy the ticket and join our fun.
And Laurence will be on. We've got a schedule on the page, and Laurence will be involved again. So if you got more questions for Laurence, you can hit him again.
Make a list. Make a list. Anybody else is going to be speaking there? Yes.
All right. I have 8 o'clock. I think this has been great, been dynamic. There's way more questions here than I can possibly put out here. I mean, there's lots of thank yous, Laurence, for participating. And yeah, several thank yous. And with that, I'm not going to keep Laurence up all night. You're free to leave or stay, Laurence, however you want to. I'm going to guess that there are some people that want to chat now about either Wabakimi or just about the weather in Southern Ontario. But Laurence, if you've got anything else you want to add, this is your last shot, and then we'll kind of let everybody unmute, and you're welcome to stay if you want to stay.
If anybody wants to more detail on some of the things that I've mentioned, they're certainly free to email me or check my website, wabakimimaps.com. Which will give you more contact information. Anyway, I thank you all for inviting me, and I will see you soon.